Good afternoon. Welcome to the Frank Magill Lecture. I hope that you all have been enjoying the day, the morning activities, as well as the luncheon. As you can imagine, we are very, very pleased and honored to have you all here, sharing with us this beautiful campus. I don't know if you notice how much we dress the campus for all of you. There are three occasions that we actually put our the prettiest face, you know, is convocation when we bring the new first year, graduation, and reunion. And you see how brilliant we look with all the balloons, all the flags. And I remember that even the ground crew is making sure that all the leaves are in place. And I was joking. I was joking yesterday that even the grass looks a little bit greener. I think they come and paint them, I'm telling you. Because it doesn't look like that in other times of the year. But it's a beautiful place. And that I hope that signals to you how much we appreciate you coming back. It's like we put our best to welcome you. And following on that, we also try to bring you the best in terms of presentation. And this Frank Magill lecture is a very important lecture that kind of represents a very palpable what we actually communicate to the world about Columbia Engineering. When I'm talking to parents, prospective students in all over the world, in all the business that I do, I always tell them that actually our engineers are the ones that use both sides of the brain, the left and the right side. They don't only use the quantitative side, but they also use the qualitative. And we have a great institution in which we can leverage the great intellectual prowess and capital that we have in the engineering school, but also what we have in our sibling institutions like Columbia College, Barnard, as well as our graduate schools, which actually provide a lot of stimulus in terms of the students being able to spend time, listen, and kind of getting knowledge by osmosis. Only sitting in law library and knowledge comes into their brain by just overhearing conversations about other people. And so the Magill lecture kind of really represents the best. And we have here a person that I could not have imagined a better person to give this lecture. When I met Steve Perlman, I'm telling you, you have to really work hard and keep up. The guy is so creative and can tell you so many ideas per minute that you actually say, wow, this guy is amazing. And there was one story that really struck me, and I hope that I don't embarrass Steve, but you know, he has been very talented since young. I think we have their parents, and they can attest that he was a handful, I bet, in terms of how creative he was and pushing the envelope. But it was one that he actually submitted a homework about a software modem that he has developed, like the first of its kind. And I don't think the professor saw the brilliance in the homework, and I think they didn't give Steve the grade that he expected. And then it was proven that actually what Steve had written in that particular project, it was something totally new. It was how you actually were able to do that same type of work that was done more at the hardware level to do it at the software level. And you can imagine that that was kind of the beginning of how Steve has tested the waters and pushed the envelope and really keep the faculty and all of us here in our toes. And that's what we say, we wanted those type of students. When I talk to the admission officers, I say, you know those kids that drive you crazy, that, you know, always trying to push the envelope? You know, we want a lot more of those here. And I think Steve, with his intellect, his creativity, his passion, and I think you will see it today as you come there. But I also have to share with you some of the things that he has done, which is quite impressive. He has over 100 patents. I'm telling you, you thought I was lying when I said that he can throw you ideas to you. I don't know what kind of revolution, but it's really incredible. He's the founder and CEO of Rearden, graduate of Columbia in 1983, a degree in computer science, and he started working for Apple Computer. He actually worked on the development of QuickTime, and you know that we are still using that. And in 1995, created Web TV. Then he went on and has built some of the programs that you are going to see today, OnLive. He also developed Mova, technologies for the iPhone, for video iPods, and a lot of works in the Macs and the PCs. He have been deployed, some of these technologies have been deployed in DirecTV, Dish, Comcast, Time Warner, Charter, Adelphia Cable TV, and Satellite TV networks. And products are also have been created include Mova Contour, Reality Capture, and the Moxie Media Center. And some of that work, you may have seen it, and actually it's part of his title, in that great movie, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button, in how you actually age back, I think was quite impressive. And he also worked, and for that, they won an Academy Award for Best Visual Effects in 2008. And I know that some of your work also were in the Angelina Jolie and some of the kind of the kind of graphics tools that they have done. So I'm just telling you that every time I talk to Steve, I have visited him in California, I come back and saying, wow. So please help me welcome Steve to the podium.
Thank you very much. It's really an honor to be here, and thank you very much for your kind words. And I think he kind of went through pretty much what I'm going to talk about, so I'm opening up to Q&A. No. So we're going to be talking today about three different companies, two of which are out there, been announced, and the third thing, why Shannon's Law isn't. This is actually the first time we're publicly unveiling, won't give you too much detail, but we're probably unveiling a very major new thing that we've just accomplished. And they all are related. And that's the most interesting thing at all about all of it. And you know, one of the things you'll find as you go through this presentation that, just as the dean was saying, these are not just engineering accomplishments for the sake of engineering. I mean, this is applied science. You know, we, at least in my view, engineering is creating things that are useful for people, you know, that make a difference in their lives. And so all of these things, as you see, are very specific inventions for the different types of applications we are seeking to do. So my background, here I went through it. I think you can take away from this is that, A, I can't hold down a job. And B, I've been around the block, so I've gotten to see the better and the worst of everything. I never imagined that I'd someday be a CEO of a company, but I ended up doing it because the kind of things we were doing, I really felt I needed to steer things, so I ended up running companies later on. Also, I would not allow things to fail that should not fail. Android's a good example of that. I take absolutely no credit for Android, except for the fact that my good friend Andy Rubin, who started it when, showed it to me, and I tried to help him find venture capital for it, and you know, he had VCs come and I'd say, what do you think of the thing? He says, are you kidding? He's trying to like boil the ocean. Yeah. I mean, he's gonna have to get 1% of the cell phone market for this to make sense. And so I said, well, yeah. And so they wouldn't fund him. So I provided the seed funding for Android. I think it has 35% now. And anyways, I've also seen what it's like to work at a large organization. Some of the technologies, you know, the main thing about FIRST is not so much that there's any particular brilliance here. Takeaway from FIRST is that what we had to do was deal with the fact that there was no context for these things when we developed them. And as much as anything else, the challenge with these technologies was explain to people the relevance of them when we developed them. And there's been lots of revenue coming in, that's good. It's allowed me to fund other things. Just about all the money I've made, I fold back into the work I've done. And lots of jobs have been created. Some of these logos are familiar. Some were colossal failures, and so they're probably not. But either way, I learned from all of them. So what I've been busy doing for the last 12 years, when I started this company, you see the logo up there, Rearden, is what I would call reinventing invention. I get very frustrated working for these various companies, large and small, and with venture capital, even talking to university research and working in corporate environments about what it took to do very fundamental work. I really admire the work of people like Edison, you know, people like the Wright brothers, etc. Some of the fundamental work with radios. And it didn't seem like there was any way to do that kind of work anymore. So the Rearden Incubator concept basically was, let's go and develop a bunch of very high-risk projects that may never work. Okay, let's go try to do things that matter but may never work. But if they do work, it would fundamentally change industries. And then let's hope that, you know, we'll have a diversity of these things. Let's hope at least one of them works. And if it does work, let's go and build a business around it. And that's, you know, difficult in and of itself, of course. And then whatever the proceeds are, fold it back into the incubator. And my particular interests have to do with art and technology. You know, I like movies, video games, things like that. So that was a focus. And the other thing is, you know, I was always frustrated that nobody, it was always really high-end equipment, you know, studios or labs and things that I could never get access to when I was trying to start things up. So we opened our doors, and we'd have visiting artists, other people trying to do startups, etc. Or, you know, when Android is getting kicked out of their office for not being able to pay the rent, I'd come over with some money, that kind of thing. And the other thing we did, which is not something I originally pursued in the beginning, was as we were doing these technologies, you find these other things fall out of it. And we realized that if there's some significant med tech discoveries, it's too important to not pursue these things. So we have some projects we're doing in that direction as well. Okay, so what's the problem of things that Rearden is not? Rearden is not a venture capital and angel fund. Venture capital used to invest in companies like the early Intel, the early Apple, where they didn't really know what a microprocessor is good for or what a personal computer is good for. But today, venture capital is considered a class of investment, and they tend to do low to medium risk investments, and they're built largely upon known technologies. There's not much money for basic technology anymore. And they do expect a return in just 2 to 3 years, and if you're working on something really hard, you can't guarantee you can do that. Corporate R&D also is not much better. They primarily are focused on extending whatever products the company has, and they expect, you know, some sort of marketable product within a year or two, at least strategic. And I do list pharma as an exception there. They do have a longer horizon. And then university research can do things with a longer horizon, but they're not product focused. I mean, it's publication focused, if you will. You know, that's the number one publish or perish, you know, kind of mantra that you have. So I decided to go and form Rearden to not be any of those things. So first of all, let's go and have an invention primer. And I put U.S. invention because the particular things I'm describing here work in the United States, at least for the next few weeks, for law changes. And it's important because this, the process you're seeing here is uniquely American. It's the way the light bulb was developed, it's the way the airplane wing and of course the eventual airplane was developed, etc. And we're going to talk about what led to Mova contour. So the first thing you do when you're inventing something, you start with a problem, you know, something needs to be solved. And this particular case, the problem had to do with capturing the human face accurately for computer-generated movies and video games. And what they were doing before is they would have these markers, which were perfectly fine for skeletal capture, but they put them all over the face of the actor, and then they try to capture, and then from that have the computer triangulate on those little dots and try to recreate the face. The faces didn't look real, it was very uncomfortable for the actors. And they also discovered this phenomenon called the uncanny valley, which remarkably was first figured out by some guy in 1970, which is that the human brain begins to look at faces and sees them as more pleasing, you know, more desirable, as they go from more representational to more realistic, all the way up to the point we get to a 3D caricature, like Princess Fiona. But when the face gets more real, but it's not perfect, then there's a huge drop-off to the point we actually don't like it. It's just the way our brain is programmed. Probably it's because we think the person has a disease or some other problem, and we're rejected by it. So when you get an almost right computer-generated face, it's worse than a cartoon. So we knew that we would have to get up to the point where the face was indistinguishable for a real face in order to overcome the uncanny valley so people could look at a computer-generated face and like it. And it, we didn't know it at the time, but we would need to have accuracy of capturing in 3D to a tenth of a millimeter in order to achieve that. So what we set out to do was try lots of different things. And the first thing you do is you try the prior art. So we actually put markers on the face of a character. And here's a little movie that kind of shows what that looks like. And you'll see her face come closer in a minute. And we just had a stand-in character for this scene. Doing a pretty good job simulating cloth. But ooh, look at that face. Is that horrible? Okay, so that was not going to do it, but that was the state of the art, All right. And so what we did is, okay, let's try lots of different ideas. We actually tried, in the end, there was about 100 distinct inventions that we went through. This was one of them. We were pursuing putting a mask on the face of a character and then using an airbrush to spray a pattern, have the computer track the pattern. It seemed like a good idea. Again, avoid being a test subject, but the results weren't all that great, to be honest. Yuck. All right, so what you're seeing there is the computer is having a little trouble tracking the lines. But what we discovered when we were doing this was that the spray that went around the edges of the slots in the mask, which is making a random pattern on the face, the computer, the cameras had no trouble correlating on that. And so then what we did, we said, all right, suppose what we do is we take a face and we sponge on it, actually glow-in-the-dark Halloween makeup, and sponge on a random pattern everywhere, all right? Then what would happen is one camera, of course, would find a random pattern in one spot. Another camera would scan the face, so it found exactly that same pattern. Of course, that random pattern would appear nowhere else. And the correlation of a pure random pattern is extremely high. Well, we didn't have the reason it's a little bumpy here is that we didn't have the calibration just right, but this shows what the face looked like with the phosphorescent makeup. We were using blue LEDs to illuminate it. This is what the black and white camera saw in terms of the random pattern. And then this is the 3D surface reconstruction, and then this is a 3D surface reconstruction with the bluish video overlaid on top of it. And we realized, even with this, with all the bumpy imperfections, that we had finally crossed the uncanny valley. And this was the breakthrough. So, as you can see, it's just amazing how real that is, even though it's completely computer-generated. All right. So, what that led to was further refinements. You can see here the glow-in-the-dark makeup and color. And then, so here's the original face. Here's the glow-in-the-dark makeup and color. Here's the 3D surface. Here's the video from here mapped on top of that. And then most importantly, this is the tracking mesh. We could actually track the 3D surface as it moved, all right? So we'll see what that looks like.
Hi, I'm Lisa Jo, and this is Contour Surface Capture.
So we had done it, and we had cracked a problem that had really...
Okay, we
got it the first time. So we had cracked the code, really, and we had solved a problem that had bedeviled the special effects community for decades. And we did further refinements. We have some fun things here. So we showed it at the SIGGRAPH trade show that year. This was 2006.
Well, this is last time. I take one kneecap this time. Next time, I take your head and I bring it.
Now look at the subtle motions of his nostrils, the cheeks, all the little things, his neck. This is what brings the face to life.
She's got a nice baby smile.
All right. And the thing that was great about it is we could go and not just map an actor's face so it looks like the actor. We could go beyond that.
Great, you bozos.
And this also goes to show that, if you listen carefully, you could hear the crew laughing in the background. We had hired this model, and she's very feminine. We said, okay, we need you to be tough, be a real tough thing. And this is the best she could do. And so it was an outtake, and we said, why don't we throw the outtake on this tough guy? And, of course, it turned out to be a very funny little thing. All right, so we had developed a technology that not only could, create a very realistic human face, but could actually remap a human face. And so after SIGGRAPH, this is the other thing about being an inventor. So we are extolled. As you can see, we ended up on the front page of New York Times. And we also were demeaned. Jupiter Research, who reviewed it, said, not the only Steve with a reality distortion field. Okay. And then here, what nobody knew at the time is we were secretly working with Digital Domain that was doing the special effects on a movie called The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. That was being directed by David Fincher. And so he got a quote from him that he made fun of. He said, Ed said, Steve is really onto something here, said Ed Ulbrich, Vice President of Digital Domain, a Hollywood special effects company in Venice, California. The holy grail of digital effects is to be able to create a photorealistic human being. It's been used in stunts and big effects scenes, Mr. Ulbricht said. Now you can use it for two actors sitting at a table and talking. You have the ability to tell stories and have close-up scenes that make you laugh and cry. And this analyst said, two actors sitting at a table, wow. So basically, he considered this particular work and that particular quote to be one of the silliest things in the world. And that wasn't the only thing that was a problem. This particular green face here and the two other faces that in the New York Times, that's my assistant, Lisa Cohen, and I said, Lisa, you're on the cover of the New York Times. She's, my face is green. So I was getting it from all sides, all right? No, just kidding. She was terrific. And by the way, don't ever come work for one of my companies because you will be subjected to the same thing that lab rats are subjected to at other companies. All right, well, anyways, so of course the movie A Curious Case of Benjamin Button did come out. Have some of you seen the movie?
Yeah.
Yes, okay. And it did not win an Academy Award for the movie, but it did win an Academy Award. In fact, the award goes to Digital Domain, who did the special effects, for the facial capture, because it was the breakthrough that, of course, the industry was waiting for a long time. This movie had been in development for almost, you know, people had tried to do this movie. It was a F. Scott Fitzgerald story from the 1920s. Been trying to do the movie for literally almost 50 years. And nobody could do it because it would cry, you couldn't do it with practical makeup, you know, with the face had to get smaller, for example, and be completely realistic. So what we have here is from the TED conference, the head of Digital Domain talking about.
Then we came across some remarkable technology.
The work they did.
Contour. And here you can see a subject having phosphorescent makeup stippled on her face. And now what we're looking at is really creating a surface capture as opposed to a marker capture. The subject stands in front of a computer array of cameras, and those cameras can frame by frame reconstruct geometry of exactly what the subject's doing at the moment, right? So effectively you get 3D data in real time of the subject. And if you look in a comparison, on the left, we see what volumetric data gives us, and on the right, you see what markers give us. So clearly, we were in a substantially better place for this. But these were the early days of this technology, and it wasn't really proven yet. But, you know, we measure complexity and fidelity of data in terms of polygonal count. And so, on the left, we were seeing 100,000 polygons. We could go up into the millions of polygons. It seemed to be infinite. This is when we had our aha. This was the breakthrough. This is when, like, okay, we're going to be okay. This is actually going to work. And the aha was, what if we could take Brad Pitt and we could put Brad in this device and use this contour process and we could stipple on the phosphorescent makeup and put him under the black lights and we could in fact scan him in real time performing Ekman's fax poses, right? So effectively we ended up with a 3D database of everything Brad Pitt's face is capable of doing. So from there, we actually carved up those faces into smaller pieces and components of his face. So we ended up with literally thousands and thousands and thousands of shapes, a complete database of all possibilities that his face is capable of doing.
All right, so that's the same guy that gave the quote that they were making fun of. And then this is actually a capture. It's a real life capture. Again, it's the first time we've shown this.
Well, I heard Mama and Daisy whispering that I was going to die soon, but maybe not.
But even look at how the neck is captured. So that's Brad Pitt, and that's the capture. And then this is the scene that it went into. And you tell me whether you think, it's not two people sitting at a table, it turned out to be two people under a bed. But tell me whether or not this was worthwhile. So there it is, science and art connected together. And basically to the guy who thought that this whole thing was a joke. Yeah. It's one of the rare occasions that the inventors won. All right, so since then, we did a lot of movies. You notice that in 2008, we did two movies. The Hulk was the other movie we did right when we introduced the technology. And then there was a lull where people went to see how those movies did, and then we suddenly got tons of work, and now we have so many movies now, we barely can keep up with the work. The new Harry Potter movie has it, Tron Legacy, Pirates of the Caribbean, which is out right now, has our work in it, Transformers about to come out, and so on. All right, so this slide is, again, maybe something that you read about in history books, because this is It took 5 years to develop this technology. I just showed you 5 years of development in about 10 minutes. But as you can see, we really had to start with a lot of different ideas in the beginning. We had 25 different things. Literally, it started out with ideas on whiteboard about different ways you can capture a face. These little lines here show how far we pursued them before we felt we hit a dead end. And then one of them, is, remember the lines on the mask, seemed very promising. We tried lots of different iterations. None of them worked. But we had a key insight that, that led to rethinking of using random patterns that we had done before, combined with also using phosphorescent makeup. And that combined together led to success. And then we had to do a bunch of practical refinements, not use those blue LEDs, get it so we can get real, you know, better quality light. And then we had to reduce the cost. We had, you know, come up with a way of making actually fluorescent lights flash. We created a new fluorescent light valves by using MOSFETs to switch them about in about a millionth of a second. Normally you think fluorescent lights turn slowly, but we were able to get them going fast. And then also better makeup that would stretch with the skin and so forth. Those inventions together led to the results here. The reason I say that this is a uniquely American process is in other countries, you have to file patents the minute you conceive of an idea. It's the first to file, so you race the patent office. In the United States, at least for the next few weeks, we're still a first to invent country, where you can you only file the patents that actually relate to the final invention. So we only filed 7 patents instead of 100, which is why we have such a robust startup economy here. All right, so don't worry, I won't be on a political soapbox too long. It's an unfortunate thing, but nonetheless, this and everything else is something that we have to, you know, keep on persevering beyond. So we developed this wonderful facial capture technology, but we had other things that we were doing at Rearden. And one of those things was something called OnLive. And in fact, I'm going to let OnLive, Mova, introduce OnLive all by itself.
Hi, I'm Jennifer. Welcome to OnLive.
So we did this. Facebook was on the rise. We figured we can outdo Facebook with the next little piece here.
Hi, I'm Jennifer. Want to be my friend?
So there you go. Now, how come our valuation isn't the same as theirs? All right. Anyways. Okay. So what OnLive is, it's a cloud gaming technology. What it allows you to do is to play video games, and you'll soon see later in the presentation do a lot more than video games. But you can play the very latest high-end games, and you can play them instantly. You don't need a high-end game machine or a high-end computer. You don't even need a high-end tablet. Any game of any level of sophistication, including one that has a face as real as the one you just saw, can easily be played on any device, whether it's a TV, PC, Mac, phones, and tablets. And because it's cloud-based, and of course cloud-based means the servers are in a data center far away. In this case, the demonstrations we're going to give you, the servers are in a data center in Virginia. It's about 250 miles away from here. We can keep upgrading those servers. We're not limited by the performance of wherever we are. And you don't need to upgrade anything locally. So it was integrated, incubated by Rearden and spun out in 2007. And it took 9 years to develop this technology. And our investors include some pretty well-known companies. And we have about 200 people now in San Francisco and Palo Alto. We just announced on Thursday, actually, that we'll be introducing OnLive in the UK this autumn. And we have lots of partners. So we had to get this thing and really show it worked. And it took many years, actually, to build up this list. And it's getting faster. In fact, I even had added Disney. Disney just joined. They're offering their games on OnLive. So how does OnLive work? Well, what we do is if you have a, say, a TV, or you have this little box here. It's called the OnLive microconsole. It's a very, very small little box that you hook up to your TV. Or use Vizio, for example, has announced they're building TVs with OnLive built in. And that will hook up to your TV. If you have a PC or Mac, then what you do is you simply have a plug-in, you know, it's about 6 megabyte download into your browser. Or on a tablet, be it an iPad or an Android tablet or a smartphone, you just download a small app. So suppose you want to play a game. Well, then you hit a button on the controller, hit a button on the keyboard, touch the screen, The controller action is sent up through the internet, through whatever your connection is, to a data center that's near you. The game, the server running the data center figures out the next frame of the game, then using a new compression technology that not only is very low latency, very low lag, but also is extremely error tolerant, it streams the video back down. And this entire round trip is so fast that perceptually it seems like the game is running locally. And to do that, we had to develop a brand new way of doing video compression. Now, if you ever use Skype or any other video teleconference system and you wave your hand, you know there's a lag, okay? It's been inherent to the way video compression technologies has always been. In fact, when we developed QuickTime, we just were never thinking about that delay because we're doing linear video. And we knew we had to make it so that for this experience to seem instantaneous, that lag would have to go away. We also had to make it work reliably over home network connections. And we had to make it work at low bandwidth. So we did all that, and we made it work and work, and of course, we would get demeaned and extolled all at once, once again. And the thing I love about this, OnLive has been out there for about a year now. And just for this lecture, I did a Google search result on OnLive, and this is a search page that came up last night. And if you look here, down here, it says, why OnLive can't possibly work. And so it's still one of the top, it's on the first page of search results saying this technology, this article isn't questioning whether or not OnLive is a good idea. It basically says we're violating laws of physics. It says that it's rather insulting. It says some unkind things about the people that are suggesting such a thing could ever work. And it nonetheless, it reflects again the way people react to fundamental inventions. This guy's not a bad guy who wrote this thing. It's just people are just not used to things coming out of the woodwork. But that's what we've done. But the thing that's also interesting is Google also tells you what are the most common searches that people do with the word OnLive. OnLive stock and OnLive stock symbol, OnLive price. Well, I guess somebody's interested in the company and thinks there's some promise. So again, you never get anything in the middle where someone said, this is okay. They're like, this is awful and you're really stupid. Or this is amazing, where can I invest? You just get nothing in between. All right, so how about a demo? Let's go show you a little bit of OnLive. So I'm going to move the connector over to this OnLive game system here. And there's the video. And once you start it up, and we'll get the audio. All right, great. So, what you're seeing now is OnLive, this image here of OnLive is actually running on a computer in a data center in Virginia. It's being streamed up here. And we actually have another one here that's running off of this micro console onto this TV here. So it's two separate streams running over the same internet connection. So what's cool about OnLive is you can go to something called the arena and you can watch people playing games. So these are all games that are in play right now. And so here's a Batman game, for example. And we can go and find out about that player and find out they joined last November. And we can add them as a friend. I can do voice chat, talk to them. Someone else is playing some basketball here. If I think they're doing some great things, I can give them a cheer. So they just got a cheer, etc. Here's a game called Assassin's Creed, which takes place in Renaissance Italy. So, you know, it's a role-playing game. Just look at the realism. And literally, you don't know where these people are. They could be in Asia, they could be in Europe, they could be in California, Florida, South America, anywhere in the world. All right? So it's a whole new view of the world. So if I want to go play a game, it's really easy. Suppose I want to go into Virtua Tennis. So Virtua Tennis, first of all, I can go and play here. And the game will start up. Now, this is a video game that normally takes probably about 2 minutes to boot up in a computer or in a or on a on a console. Bring down the audio just a tad, it's a loud game. And as you see, it started up in 2 seconds. Why is that? We keep the games running on the servers, so when you connect to the server, all you do is you bind in your name and your high score, things like that, and off you go. So here we go and play, and I don't know, who should we have play? That guy there? Who else? Yeah? It's Russian? What do you think? Slovakian? Czech? I don't know. Or American? Lindsay can handle it, right? Okay. Good.
So the thing that's great about this, I could be playing with somebody elsewhere in the country, or I could play with someone in the same room with two controllers. All right?
Murray.
So now, if we go look over here, Brian's running that one. And you see, he goes in the arena, and he can watch me. He's spectating me. So I'm going to serve. And off you go. Yes, I never ever win during presentations. Okay, so this button there, you push that. I just got a clean cheer. Great, okay. And I created a brag clip. That recorded the last 10 seconds of the video. In fact, Brian can go and show you the brag clip. If he goes back out, goes to brag clips, and then he goes, that's right, there's virtual tennis. And so there it is, a little clip that the whole world can see. And Brian, your reviews are coming up. It's time for you to rate this brag clip. That's right. Good. High rating. You got it. See, my employees understand exactly how to work with the president. Okay. But anyways, would anybody like to try this? Anyone want to play some tennis? Dean, no? Yeah, anyone else? Okay. Yeah, come on. All right. So this is left and right, and then these various buttons are different. Yes, all right? Okay. They tell me whether or not the game is playable. And there's no reason why you shouldn't be able to watch this on your iPad. So these iPads. probably don't need to make a brag clip. But anyways, as you can see, it works. We have an iPad. And off you go. And we're going to pass these around, and you can go and look at not just this one, but if anyone likes to try the iPad out. Pass it around? No? There you go. And okay. So we have a few iPads for passing around. Okay, come on. There's two more points, I think. And then make a brag, press the circle button. The circle button at the bottom, here. Yep, you just create a brag clip. Actually, no. No, you have to have a little bit of agility, but actually, there's different levels, you know. Let's see what happens here. Oh, yeah! Nice job. Let's see, so you got a message. So people that are watching you send you a message. Okay, now you gotta hand it back. Okay, so as you can see, that game was actually running on a server 250 miles away. Now, how's the response time?
Great.
It felt like you're playing the game right here, okay? And again, people thought that was impossible. In fact, we have one guy who still thinks that it can't possibly work. So what you did can't possibly work. So you just violated some raw physics, and I'm sure that's well good. Well, that's what they should be telling you in Columbia Engineering. And so anyways, it's really cool. You know, we can go into brag clips here and you'll see that we have already, we have, you know, people not only put brag clips like that, but they put in really funny ones. Like here, he jumped onto a motorcycle, and then he manages to jump to the roof of the tunnel. Because there's a bug in the software. And so we put the bug. And I'll show you some other hilarious ones. This one here. This guy managed to hook his car onto an airplane. And it kind of slammed into it. Wow. Now, what's cool about it is I can now share this onto Facebook and post it as a cool brag clip. I won't go through the whole process here. But it's a fully integrated system. And take a look at these cool 3D effects. You're going to have live video moving in 3D. This is all running off a little box. All right, why? Because all of this high performance computing is happening remotely in servers 250 miles away. Okay, so that gives you a quick preview of OnLive, the game service. Is some of you looking at it on the iPad so you can navigate around? So make sure we get at least a couple of the iPads back.
So now what we're going to do is switch over to something that we haven't shown too much of, which is OnLive not being used for games, but OnLive is used for productivity and enterprise. So gaming was the hardest problem to solve. I mean, it requires absolutely, millisecond, resolution response time in order to be able to play the games. Productivity applications are far more tolerant. Do you want to switch over to the other micro console? Productivity applications are far more tolerant from latency point of view, and they don't have, the screen usually doesn't change around nearly as rapidly, so the compression challenges were not as hard. So we figured if we could solve this for video games, then we could solve it for anything. Well, I mean, that's a pretty profound thing. That means you don't need local computing for anything anymore, really. You don't need even a laptop or even a tablet's level of computing. So it opens the door for not just having high performance computing for things that are really hard to compute, just the whole convenience and the upgrade side of it. There's a company called Citrix, for example, which does this very thing, but it's kind of hard to use because it's not real time when using the applications. And the other thing that we're very excited about is, for example, educational applications for people that are too far away to get access to certain technologies, like having educational applications for third world countries and things like that. And perhaps having an application like AutoCAD in a country where they could not afford to have the computing resources or even the application, and then have a person spectate and chat with them and help them in designing a bridge. Or even have it tied in with another application that says they could find the raw materials. Here's some scrap iron that could be used for this bridge. Okay, so this is set up, it looks just like the game system. We have a couple of quote-unquote games that are not quite the same. And where's the, any one of the iPads to demo this? So iPads are famous, some may say infamous, because they don't do a great job with Adobe Flash. And with OnLive, though, we don't have that issue. Because what we can do is, of course, have a server in a data center far away that's running a browser, it's running Flash or anything else. And then, of course, we can stream it in real time directly to the iPad. Now, one of the things that I'm already seeing, this is probably going to have to be restarted. The E3 show is our big show for video games. It's next week. And we have all these new features we're introducing. And so everything's in transition. So whatever build this is the one I got. And it's clearly not starting up. But the cool thing is, when we get it working, is, oh, no, I'm wrong. Just took a little while to get going. All right, there we are. So what I'm going to do is jump into a browser here. And so here I am browsing. And the browser is not running on the iPad in this case. Of course, our website doesn't have Flash, so it would run on an iPad. But suppose I go to this site. This website is a Mercedes-Benz site, and he's spectating, so you can watch it on the screen exactly what's on the iPad. This website is famous for being one of the most complex websites ever made. Okay, so we're not just talking about a Flash site, we're talking about a crazy Flash site. Now, you see how fast that all that loaded in? Those things, if you're on like a 6 megabit DSL line or a cable modem line, this site may take a minute to load. But in our data center, we have 10 gigabit connections to the internet. So this is the fastest browser in the world by orders of magnitude. All right? And it's not even supposed to be running on a iPad. So, but anyways, if I want to change the color of the car, boom, change the color of the car, etc. You have the full Flash capability. Want to go look at the exterior here, I can go and check that out. It plays a video, full touch capability. So, not only can we run Flash, but we can run something that Microsoft's not running on their mobile devices yet, which is Silverlight. It's a kind of equivalent to Flash that Microsoft has. And this is the Hard Rock site that I'm going to now. And it's kind of cool. One of the neat features of Silverlight, you see I'm using the pinch capability, is that you can zoom in to incredible detail with, if you want to, in an image here. And here I'm using, the pinch and stretch capability of my fingers and, just as a normal touch thing. But of course this browser is running 250 miles away. So as you can see, we've really gone and changed the rules of the game. I mean, this is not just an application on the iPad. This is every application on the iPad.
And so that's an application that's a relatively low-performance application, but how about an application that's a high-performance application? This is going to take a couple minutes to load, because we don't even optimize for the fast load. But this, one of the investors in OnLive is Autodesk, and the application we're about to run is Maya. And Autodesk Maya is a $6,000 piece of software, okay, with the way it's configured here. It is the tool that is used when they're doing, when they made the faces in the Curious Case of Benjamin Button, when they made the faces that you saw in the demos here. And obviously, an application, that application can't run on my laptop. It most certainly can't run on a mobile device. But you still might want to go to a client's office. You might want to go and use it while you're traveling, etc. So we now have it starting up. And he can spectate me again so you can see what's going on. And I will go and first load the model. And this is the same model that we had. We can see that this is a 3D model that we had when we were giving the demo before, when she said, hi, welcome to OnLive. You notice her eyes follow you as I move around. And as you can see with the kind of weird, huh? And you can zoom in to that level of detail in the skin and see the surface of it, right? And I can also cause it to play.
Meeting so soon. Come back when you can.
All right. So, there you go. Again, we're trying to compete with Facebook, doing everything we can. No, just kidding. So, that just gives you an example of, again, the possibilities that exist with this technology. What we've done is not just make a cloud gaming system. What we've done is made a general solution for cloud computing. And I would argue that pretty much every other solution for cloud computing that exists today is a hybrid solution, where part of it is in the cloud and part of it is in the local device. And the power of what we've just done is just mind-boggling. And I really think that it's going to be completely transformative. Now, once again, I want to remind you those demos couldn't possibly work, in case you were wondering what was happening there. And then I think people are some. I want to leave plenty of time for Q&A, so I'm going to show this real quick. I think people like to see how these things come into being. So, OnLive, as I said, was about 9 years of work. Well, actually, at this point, probably about a decade. And this shows the work that we did. And nobody would ever fund the company. It wasn't until 2007 they brought in the first funding. And this work is some of the work that we did before we had our first dollar of funding. Oops, sorry. I'm just trying to make that bigger. But you can see here that, let's see, make it full screen. This was our an early version of that arena that you saw. And we were showing this and saying, look how cool this will be. And they said, you'll never make this work. You know, never, it'll never be at work at scale. It'll never work over consumer connections. It'll be impossible. And this is an early version of the brag clips and the user profile page.
Hey, man, this is Killhazard. I'm here to kick your ass.
Now, at the time, by the way, we were thinking we would ship it with a camera. And we will have that feature eventually. But as you can see, some of the things we conceived many, many years ago still have not yet been implemented. And here he's going to go look at a brag clip he made before. Just like the brag clip we just did. So there you have it. You know, to get from here to something that works reliably 250 miles away on every different kind of device, needless to say, it was a very long journey. And so this is where we are now. We've been up 24/7 for a year. Because the taste in video games is very similar in US and Europe, that's why you see such a high density in those two markets. But we're gradually adding new games that are appealing to other markets, especially Asia. This is another problem we haven't solved yet. Maybe we should work on it, which is something about overcoming the speed of light. But again, nothing's impossible. So we have three data centers in the US, and the reason is that this shows a 1,000-mile range, roughly, from each data center. And that, at about a 1,000-mile range, with the technology we developed, perceptually, it seems like the games respond instantly. If you go further than that, it can be in a fast-action game that appears to be some lags. That's why we have three data centers. And you can see the density of users. The density map there, by the way, almost exactly matches the density map of population in the US. And this shows a test data center that we have in Europe. Because Europe geographically is smaller, we can have literally one data center serve all of Western Europe and just look at the density of users. This is just the people testing it. It's kind of crazy. We have partners with major telecom operators, and OnLive is going to be available on all different kinds of devices. TVs, as you know, tablets, smartphones,
PCs, Macs, etc. Much like today you can get Netflix on any of these devices, you can count on the same thing being true for OnLive. Vizio, which is the largest manufacturer of TVs in the U.S., is building OnLive into all their TVs. HTC, which is the largest, or they're very close to largest, either them or Samsung, Android manufacturer, is building OnLive into all their tablets and smartphones. And obviously we have OnLive in the iPad. By the end of the year, we'll be in 25 million internet TVs, 50 million Blu-ray players and set-top boxes, 250 million tablets and smartphones, and 400 million PCs and Macs. And all of this time, this can't possibly work. Just to remind everyone. Okay, so the thing I want to show you sort of last for this thing before I get into the Shannon thing, because I don't want a lot of time for Q&A, is a video that really can't possibly work, because this shows a preview of some of the new games that are going to be possible with OnLive that are hyper-realistic and are essentially, if you will, starting with what we did with Venture and Button and now taking advantage of the unlimited server capacity and computing capacity in a data center. So the question is, you know, you saw in Venture and Button, the face was computer-generated, a couple other things were, the rest of it was live action. So take a look at this video, and the quiz question for you is, what percentage of it live action and what percentage is computer generated? And just as a small footnote is that the studio that did this work is the same studio that did the same studio did that woman pirate simulation with us early on. And look how far we've come. So is the face real? Is the clothing real? Is the hypodermic? How about the rain and the set? Are these actors, their gear, how much of it's real? How much of it's computer generated? What about the glow for the neon lights, etc.? You know. How about the steam? Is that real? How about the glass and the hypodermic? How about the, you know, the motion of that string? Is the string real, right? How about the warm ground? Or the flow of Batman's cape? Is that real?
You knew. You knew we could have taken care of him. You knew we were no match for him.
Yes, but soon we will be.
Twist of the knife to test
you.
Smoke effect.
Who sent you?
Rain on people's faces. So, any takers? What percentage is live action? What percentage is computer generated? Oh man, you guys are no fun at all. You are no fun at all. Oh, that's what happens when I give a lecture at an engineering school. Okay, yes, that entire, everything there is computer generated. Pretty cool, huh? All right, any clues that people see some things that didn't look real, or just that you, what things didn't look real? Uh-huh. Looks a little gelatinous, perhaps, with the rain on it or something. Uh-huh. The smoke effects are pretty good. All right. How about the rain, you know, coming down? How about the glow from the lights, etc.? Pretty cool, huh? So, again, this is the exact same company, exact same director that did that woman pirate thing when we started on this project. And look where we are now. Isn't that cool? So... OnLive is not just the future of gaming, but here's a prediction I won't make here. I think it's the future of movies. There was a point where color film was like this novelty. It was ridiculously expensive to make a color movie instead of a black and white movie. And then at some point, it became more expensive to make a black and white movie
than a color movie because no one's making black and white stock anymore, right? And of course today, if you try to, well, to make a movie on film is more expensive, right? So with sets and all the things you have to build and relying on the weather and everything else, it's getting increasingly more expensive to make a movie. And if you can make something that looks that real, and you can do it all in a studio and at, you know, with the schedules that are available for the different players, you may not even have the same actors in the same scene there at the same time. Why not? All right, so the last thing I'm gonna talk about, then we'll have time for a question and answer, is why Shannon's Law isn't. Does anyone know what Shannon's Law is? No, all right, well, let me tell you what Shannon's Law. Okay, so this guy Claude Shannon was an absolute genius. What he did, came up with in 1948, I kid you not, was figuring out what the capacity, the data capacity, how many bits per second you can carry on a channel. Of course, at the time, he was mainly thinking about phone lines. He was working at Bell Labs. But, and this is the formula. But what it means to us, and where it's really affecting our society right now, is it sets the limit for wireless data capacity. It's the reason we have dropped call, dead zones, congestion. I mean, ultimately, when you go and look at all the reasons why we have these limitations, it comes from the limit that is derived from Shannon's Law right here, right? And the problem we're running into is that there's just not enough spectrum. This is one of the largest stadiums in the world in Michigan. It seats over 100,000 people. And suppose that, you know, I'm sure you've been in a stadium, you've probably pulled out your cell phone and you want to watch a video and it doesn't work very well, does it, right? Well, the reason is that this area in the stadium is like one channel, okay? It's one shared wireless space. You can't do beamforming to select out individual users. So we're all going to share the same channel. And, you know, only a small fraction could really watch video at once. And the problem's getting worse. I mean, New York City is like a stadium that's worse than a stadium because there's walls that interfere and block the wireless signals. And the problem is, you know, over half, almost half, and just about, and it's growing, almost half of wireless cellular capacity now is carrying video. It's just getting to be worse. And it's outstripping our ability to build wireless infrastructure. And so, according to Shannon's Law, there's simply not enough usable spectrum. So that's pretty bad news for all the different things we'd like to do. I think we'd all like to eventually drop wires altogether. So I'm afraid I have bad news. As far as I can tell, Shannon came up with the right answer. The good news is he asked the wrong question. And what Rearden has done, and this is the first time I'm saying it, so I guess it's sort of a bit of an announcement, is we've come up with an entirely new way to do wireless. It's different than the way Marconi did wireless. It's different than the way cell phones work today. We had to make new radios. It took us years to make them. They don't modulate the way any radio that's ever been made before. They don't use wireless energy. We had to go back to very, very fundamental principles of wireless propagation in order to make this work. And so, using this new technology, shared spectrum is not limited by Shannon's Law at all. So if we go back to our stadium analogy here, we now have work in Palo Alto, we've done work in Texas as well. We can get up to 10 times what Shannon's Law says is possible, all right? So I know there's gonna be an article published that says this. Okay, so in advance, yes, you're right, it's impossible. But nonetheless, we have 10 radios all working at exactly the same frequency, all at the Shannon limit, all right? And they do not interfere with each other at all. We're optimistic we can get to, we know we get to 100x, that's not difficult from what we've seen. And we're optimistic we could even get to 1000x. And here's the thing we haven't figured out, we don't know what the limit is. This is all green fields for wireless. It's a whole new field of endeavor. Maybe we can handle this whole stadium, I don't know. I know we can do 100 times what current cellular systems are doing with the exact same spectrum. What does this mean? Well, it means there's no more dead zones, there's no more drops, no more congestions. The signal noise ratio we get is much better. By the way, our radios are much simpler. They have a single antenna, they have much less processing than a modern cell phone does. We are much faster in wireless connections for applications that matter, like OnLive. The latency is vastly lower. And here's this really crazy thing we've also got working. The signal integrity is so good that we've been able to get it to work as far as 30 miles away. That's beyond the curvature of the Earth. That's further than a television station will transmit. And theoretically, we should be able to get to about 250 miles. The reason we went up to 30 miles is it took too long driving cars back and forth from the experimental stations. So that's the limit we run into there.
All right, so...
So the final slide here is about reinventing invention. You know, invention is about formulating the right question to ask. It took me a long time to realize that. Next, one of the things that I realized about Columbia is that Columbia, I think, did an okay job helping me with answers, but the thing I perhaps learned most here was how to formulate questions, and that turns out to be key. Once you formulate the question the right way, finding an answer usually is not all that hard. The other thing, we've got a problem in the world and in America where we used to have some, you know, the VCs, the legendary VCs that, you know, founded Silicon Valley and so forth, they don't do that business anymore. We don't have anybody funding stuff like this, and I think that needs to be fixed.
I'm just one person, Rearden's one little company. There's lots more things that can be done. Maybe some of these successes that Rearden has done will serve as an example to others.
I don't like to bring political issues, but MIT, University of California, and University of Wisconsin-Madison have participated to try to stop this bill, because it's going to utterly crush startups in America. It's going to have a huge damper on research in universities, because it's going to make it so it's going to be very difficult for academics to realize funding that will come back to do more research. And it's silly. They haven't allowed a single inventor to testify after four sessions of Congress. And it's as silly as you would imagine a bill would be about invention without a single inventor testifying. So we're down to the Constitution, and that's what's before them now. There is nobody, no scholar, that believes that this bill is constitutional. So all the large companies who are behind this bill hired scholars to write papers to say it's constitutional.
Steve, what bill are you talking about?
The American Invents Act. It passed Dianne Feinstein, Barbara Boxer. They all vehemently opposed it. Because, of course, you know, California has lots of startups, and they, Maria Cantwell, she was extremely eloquent in her opposition to it. Barbara Boxer said this violates the Constitution. We have the only Constitution in the entire world that specifically reserves rights for inventors and artists. Okay. Because we are the only country that was founded by people that were like us, included engineers. They weren't called engineers back then, but people like Benjamin Franklin, Thomas Jefferson, and so on, who understood what it was like to innovate. And they understood what entrepreneurship was like. And so they want to be like the rest of the world, which will not allow this type, this style of invention, wouldn't allow the Wright brothers and Edison or the kind of work I do. Anyways, so, I don't know if there's any way we can stop it, but nonetheless, we're going to try to the last. but let's not talk about negative. Let's talk about the positive here. Invention makes the impossible possible. It's just fabulous. You know, putting your dreams transcend reality in the purest form. It really does. It is such a joy when you've worked so hard on these things to see these things come into being. And I just really, really don't hope, for all the reasons here, it does not become a lost art. Right, and I think all of us here, you know, this is what we love to do. At least that's why I got into engineering, was to go and make things. I once again thank you very much for a chance to speak with you. The bandwidth needed for HDTV is 3 to 5 megabits. I shouldn't be saying this, but I'll just say it to you guys. I don't care. We're about to roll out a new version of our algorithm. We're actually going to go down to about 2 megabits for HDTV. The beauty of having cloud computing is you get to keep evolving the algorithm, and the products get better. But right now it's 3 to 5. And then with tablets, we only need, like the iPads are here that we were running, are running at about 1.5 megabits maybe. And the 1,000-mile limit is just if you really want a fast-action game. The demos I was giving of the browser and of Autodesk were actually running from California, 3,000 miles away, roughly.
And the second question, I guess it sounds like it's a platform. So
people who actually make the games, they use the platform, is it going to be a subscription service, or is it a subscription service?
It's a free service, and what you can do is you, just go to onlive.com, you can try it out. Demos are free, there's promotional things that are free, you can spectate, do all the social things for free. And then if you like a game, you can rent the game or buy the game, and then we have a flat rate service, it's kind of like Netflix, where for $9.95 a month you get 60 plus games and you can play them all you want. So it's kind of fun. Kids love it. We haven't added the family, we just added Disney, and we're just getting enough family games. We're about to add family controls, parental controls. So now you got to keep an eye on your kids, because there's a couple of mature games there as well. You know, I'm always worried because we have voice chat now, and not if the kids are playing, but when the voice chat, I was giving a demo and I'd go spectate some, and the guy said some very colorful worlds that they were talking to, and I'm like, oh my god. The audience thought it was rather amusing, but I was very embarrassed, and I'm thinking of this August institution, but I figured you guys could handle it, so fortunately we were fine.
Chris in the back?
It was along the same line. How are you commercializing it, and how are you generating revenue online?
Well, we get revenue whenever someone does a demo, it's an ad, we get some revenue. When we get a percentage of the sale of the games, or the rental of the games, and we get a percentage of that, you know, that monthly rate for people playing the games. There'll be other ways we can monetize it. You know, we'll eventually have trailers and other things that are advertising related. And then for a service like offering something like Autodesk or something like that, we'd probably get some revenue related to the use of the servers, and so on. So the thing that's crazy about it is there's like an infinite number of ways to monetize this technology.
Hey, you scamps for Columbia.
You get the free service is half price. Actually, we brought a bunch of cards for free passes. How many we got? Well, if anybody who thinks they're really going to play games, or they really have kids who are going to play, Lisa and Brian just pass out some free cards. Some of the games are $50.
I can't do anything.
I was more curious about the way you're modulating the radios. It's ultra low frequency.
No, it isn't. It's usually, it'll work at any frequency. We've gone all the way from 3 megahertz all the way up to microwave. The particular demos that we were doing stuff at 450 megahertz. I hate to tell the story because it makes people sound bad. We talked to some VCs and everything, and we needed to. You have to get a experimental license, of course, to do any of these kinds of things. And we brought in an FCC consultant to go look at this thing, and we didn't have it all working yet because we didn't have an experimental license. And I was actually thinking of showing it here, but the stuff he said was so mean and was so demeaning to us. It's like people think they come into the world of wireless and you think you can just go and treat us all like idiots and so forth and tell us that you can rewrite well-established principles and so on, and then you go to venture capitalists and try to take money from them. And it was like horrible. And I co-invented the basic technology with other engineers, so I kind of shared it. I said, don't look, we're going to be getting an experimental license. And so I said, what do you say about this? And maybe he's right. And so, the co-inventor said, excuse my French. He said, fuck him. That was his answer. So I said, how are we going to do this? He says, well, we can go to Mexico, maybe use the spectrum there. And then he said, no, let's get amateur radio licenses. And so we got ham radio licenses, and all of this work has been done in amateur radio bands. And again, using what he said, that's sort of our response to them, to not letting us do the experiments in the United States. So, anyways, yeah.
Here, Gloria.
Yeah.
So, coming from a design perspective, I hate to bring up money at all.
Yes.
But when we're talking about Mova, I'm talking about Rearden. You're talking about the length of the time it took to develop the Mova system to where it's actually usable now and can make money.
Yes.
And obviously, Rearden is looking at a minimal number of projects that have huge impact. But in the long run, as a business for Rearden, how does that turn around? Like, how is the cash turn on that? How's the profitability of that?
Rearden is a profitable enterprise already. Because I'm somewhat irresponsible in this regard, I'm throwing more money into new things, so there's a good chance that these other things we do won't be profitable. But You know, it's a, you know, we've already derived revenue from these different things we've done, and it's fed in. I mean, for a while, there was nothing coming in the early days, and I was taking a very big risk. But again, my attitude is like, what's the point? You know, if you're not taking risks, then, you know, it's kind of like my attitude with Android. It's like, how can you not let this thing come into being, right? I know it's not a very popular thing. If I was at the business school, people would be shaking their heads, okay? But nonetheless, I don't know any other way to make these things come into being. If someone could come up with a better way with a more certainty of economic return, that'd be great.
And you were, what are your thoughts on Kickstarter?
A what?
Kickstarter?
Oh, I mean, I think it's a website you put things up there and different people bid on it.
Yeah.
You know, I think it's good for small enterprises. It's, I mean, these things, you're talking hundreds of millions of dollars have gone into these developments so far, and it's just not, it's hard to do that on a small scale. What I want to do is I want to go and have a couple success with these things. I want to go and talk to some of the venture capital guys. There's a lot of venture capital guys who are quite frustrated because they're from the old days and they know what it was like to see these breakthrough things and they want to get back to that. But you got to get the limited partners, the people that fund it, like the pension funds and things like that, they've got to be willing to take a risk, at least a small percentage of the projects. Yeah.
Gloria?
Do you have a ticker symbol?
A what?
A ticker symbol on
that one. No, none of these companies are public at this time. Different companies have been acquired, but none of these, we haven't done that. All of them are private companies. But as you can see, it's a common search thing. People search on why it can't possibly work and our stock price. Both things have nothing to do with reality. Yeah. Yes. Well, there's a couple of things. I mean, one of the things that we stumbled upon is we are finding out properties of propagation of radio waves that just have never really been looked at before, and they penetrate the skin very well. And there's different things you can do with radio waves. You can control them precisely. So we don't know, but we do think that there's some possibilities. They can be used for measurement applications. They could potentially be used for, potentially type of radio surgery, perhaps. I don't know. But the point is that when we saw these things happen, we began to see these effects. We said, you know what? Look, we can't just go and shove these aside and ignore them because we like video games. You know, these are two important phenomena. My parents are both physicians, so I'm well aware of how things like penicillin came about from a mold in a petri dish and so on. And so we'll see. I don't have anything to say about something we've created just yet. I will tell you this, we're going to pursue them and see what comes.
We're here and then over there. Yes.
Yeah. Oh, I just have to shout, right?
Yeah.
Two questions. The new radio technology, will that require tearing apart the existing wireless networks and replacing it with newer technology in order for it to run? Second question, why Rearden? You're Perlman.
No. Let's not go there.
Is that over the illusion?
Okay, so let me ask the first one. The new technology has such high SNR that we really don't need towers anymore. So a lot of the zoning issues, we don't need backhaul, if you're bringing the data connection to the towers. So we literally can have people have this network supported by an access point, much like a Wi-Fi access point, but instead of just working in your home, you can travel a kilometer or two or something. And it's just a very, very different way of looking at it. And again, it took us a while to wrap our heads around it, but there's new phenomena we're working with, and we finally come with a very simple way of doing it. But no, it does not require. I kind of imagine probably you'll come in as maybe an overbuild, where you'll have your existing cellular stuff that's well established, and then this will sort of come in, and maybe phones have both. Our radios are so much less expensive than a conventional cellular radio.
Faster than 4G.
Oh, vastly faster than 4G. I mean, the other thing is the latencies we're seeing now are on the order of sub-millisecond. So 3G might be 150 milliseconds of latency, 4G, you could in some modes get down to 40. Even at 30 miles, we're seeing maybe two and a half milliseconds. Give you an idea, DSL line can won't get below like 10 milliseconds or 15 milliseconds. So it really is a whole new world. And I believe it's a new field of study that somebody's going to have to go figure out and probably come up with a lot more clever things than we have. I mean, all we did was sort of do this really hard thing. It's hard to build radios, as anyone knows who's ever tried to do it. Most radios that are built today, when people are working with existing cellular stuff or whatever, or Wi-Fi, they've been honed by other people and they're building stuff on top of it. What we had to do was start from the ground up. I mean, we're not, you know, the idea of having a carrier or a modulator on top of it, no longer. It's a whole different way of thinking of the way you propagate this radiation, I guess. And, you know, look, it's going to evolve. It's much more primitive than any of these other things. We're going to show a demo. These are the ugliest looking things you've ever seen in your life because it's all driven by software. But it's so important, a technology, we decided, you know what, we're going to showcase it before it's all polished. And then let other people tell us better ideas than we can think of, you know?
Over there, did you have a question?
Yes.
Well,
I've
got two questions, too,
but
one of them was, how come
Rearden
and not Perlman?
Oh, okay. All right, so the what happened was, I was reading a book called Atlas Shrugged when I was at Microsoft. If you really want to know, I wanted a name that was not going to, you know, it was somewhat generic just for the stuff I was doing. So I had Artemis Research, you know, Artemis, Greek goddess, no big deal there, right? And we had built all of the web TV servers on top of Artemis.com before we got webtv.com. And there was agreement, when they were done with it, it would go back to me, okay? So when I left Microsoft, I talked to the guys, they've got all this stuff hooked up. If you pull out Artemis.com, the whole thing is going to come crashing down. So I said, okay, so here's a domain available for reardonsteel.com. Great, I grabbed that and I sent an email to everyone in the company. Here, you can reach me at this email address. It got to the Wall Street Journal, and the Wall Street Journal says, hey, Perlman started a new company called Rearden Steel, and it's a, it's a industrial age company for an information age guy. And I'm like, oh, great. And so, look, it's one of the people that love Ayn Rand, it's a big plus. People that hate Ayn Rand, it's a big minus. You really don't want a company name that's going to create that sort of thing. You know what I'm saying? No matter what your own views are. But the thing is, we got so much visibility from it that we kept it. And we got Rearden.com and so on, and it's fine. You know, I think most people just, you know, we see it as a whole other place. The companies that, the commercial names we use are ones that are a lot easier to spell. You know, like Rearden might be Ian or Owen. OnLive, Mova, you know, and so on. I think Rearden is the longest name I've used so far.
While I have you, can I just follow up on one other one? Can you talk a little bit more about the modulation with respect to your new radio transmission? Obviously, there's different properties, wavelengths, and you know that better than I could perhaps, but are you using the same modulation for each of the wavelengths, or?
Well, okay, so the modulation, so we just take one band, much like any other radio system would. So like, you know, say a 6 megahertz band, if that's what you want, 10 megahertz, whatever you want for your bandwidth, all right? And then we modulate within that band. It's just we modulate craziness. I mean, if any conventional radio were to pick it up, it would deem it to be complete garbage. It would not seem to be any signal in it at all. It seemed random. And it's utilizing, it's just, you know, everybody up till now, and it took me a year to conceptualize this, to get my head comfortable with this. We think of radio waves as sort of these invisible wires in the air. They're not. They really aren't. Okay, it's just not the way they propagate. And when you finally can wrap your head around that and realize that you can't think of it as like phone lines, and that's the problem with, that's why I said Claude Shannon's right. If they were wires in the air, then yes, what he said would be completely true. The way a cellular system would serve a stadium today is essentially, it's like they're setting up a private little wire to each person with their phone. And then they're jumping from one person to another and sharing the wires, right? That's how they all share the same spectrum. Okay, so if you can imagine, let's just say 100 people, you know, let's not go nuts. Imagine that all 100 people in that stadium, instead of having a wire going to them, instead had a little private cell around their phone, a little bubble. We think it's about the size of about half a wavelength. And there was no signal anywhere else. Okay? then that would be a better way of explaining how it is. It's different. It's not beamforming. It's not TDMA. It's not CDMA. It's just, you know, it's not FDMA. It's a new beast. And smarter people than me are going to figure out what to do with it. Perhaps I am, if you will, ignorant enough about wireless, much as this consultant eloquently put it, to not know better than to think that such a thing would be possible, all right? And then it took us over a decade to make this thing work, all right? So it is not easy to make it work, but now we figured it out. So it does work, and it's going to change everything. Sure. This audience, the last half hour is the first time I've said it to anyone in the world outside of our company, outside of other people that we tried to invest and everyone thought we were crazy. So yes, we've had the door slammed in our face many, many times in this technology. When we were trying to recruit people to work on it, we called a number of different professors and PhD students at universities that specialize in related fields in wireless. And nobody would work on it. We couldn't hire anyone. My favorite thing was one, because obviously we were reasonably sophisticated in the stuff we were asking. One guy said, "Who put you up to this?" We finally got someone to work on it. And basically what I said to him, I said, "Look, you know, prove to me that it won't work, that it can't work." And he worked on it. And and it took him a while to kind of think it through. And he finally concluded that indeed, there was a different thing that we were doing that hadn't been looked at before that opened up a new door, and then of course we grew from there. And we actually brought in his top PhD student, who's now a member of the team, who's carried the work mostly forward. Yeah, so it's been a long, long road. It's a lot harder than any of the other things we've done.
I have one more question. I know that you have been very patiently waiting, so I would like to
hear. Yeah.
This question based on an observation of your time. How has Steve Jobs influenced your creativity?
Well, okay. So, I have immense admiration for him. In fact, this world would be a lot worse place if he was not around and was not the person he is. I've worked with him for just 6 months when I joined Apple, but I didn't work directly for him. And then he got ousted. That was back in the 80s. And then I've crossed paths with him a couple of times. And just whatever reason happened. But so many people that I've worked with have worked with him. You know, when I look at something like, you know, the iPad, the iPhone, iPod, and so on, or Macintosh, certainly, he is willing to go and not be hung up on, we were talking about this at lunch, a term I use that seems to be infecting, first the whole world, and now it's infecting the United States, incrementalism. Incrementalism is where you're just going and doing something a little bit better. One of the problems is that the technologies created, particularly around the web, are so powerful now that through very, very small incremental steps, you can build a very large business. And, well, it's a magnet, it's a funding. Why take risk on things which are a big leap forward if you could make a big killing on something that's a small step forward, right? So he never does that. He doesn't even think about it. He dives into things. So look, I think it's great that he's doing what he does. He's got a different spin on things, the kind of work he does. He has an immense, incredible design sense that I don't have. I'm a little more, you know, underpinning technology kind of guy, you know what I mean?
So, let me again give a round.